the subject of today's lecture is quantum stars. We will continue with our discussion of these two questions, namely, what are the stars and why are they as they are? Yesterday, last time, we discussed gaseous stars. Today, we will discuss highly condensed stars. And I will convince you that these condensed stars cannot be understood in terms of classical physics, but you have to invoke quantum physics. The story began with the study of the companion of Sirius. I hope you know that Sirius is the brightest star in the sky. It is the next brightest object after the Moon and Venus. And Sirius has a companion, which is 10,000 times fainter than Sirius itself. This was known for a long time. And that it was a binary companion was first established by the great mathematician and astronomer Bessel. But Bessel didn't have a good enough telescope to actually resolve the companion. But then soon after Bessel, telescopes improved in quality and they could actually see the companion. But the way Bessel discovered his companion was, the motion of Sirius in the sky was not in a straight line, but it seemed to him to be an elliptical motion. So immediately, being a very clever guy, he came to the conclusion that it is going around a common center of mass, so there must be a companion. But our story begins around 1914 and 1925 with the 100-inch telescope in Mount Wilson in California. And the astronomer by name Walter Adams measured the temperature and radius of the companion of Sirius. What he found was that the mass of the companion of Sirius was roughly equal to the mass of the Sun, which was also the mass of Sirius itself. But its radius was not a million kilometers, but it was only 10,000 kilometers, like the radius of the Earth. So if you divide mass by volume, you get an astronomical density of a million grams per cubic centimeter. Nobody took notice of this, except Eddington. Why? He was terrified. He said, are such super dense stars doomed? What did he mean by that? As we saw in the first lecture, stars are gaseous blobs held together by gravity. The inward pull of gravity is balanced by the combined pressure of gas and radiation. Eddington asked himself, what will happen to the star when the nuclear reactor at its center fails? Please remember that in 1925, nobody thought that there was a nuclear reactor, that there was a furnace at the center of the star where subatomic energy was being released. All we had was the Bohr's theory of the atom. But Eddington thought he had understood all these things, and he wanted to know what will happen if this reactor fails. Since there is no further energy generation if the reactor fails, for whatever reason, the pressure supporting the star against gravity will decrease and the star will contract and eventually collapse. What will happen to the star? Will it collapse to a singularity? This was Eddington's dilemma in 1925. But I want you to appreciate that the entire astronomical community wasn't bothered by this at all, because nobody was looking as far ahead as Eddington anyway. Right? But this question was resolved very soon by Sir Ralph Fowler. He was a professor of theoretical physics in Cambridge University, a colleague of Eddington in Cambridge. And this is how this story unfolded. Dirac was a young student of Fowler in Cambridge. In August 1926, Dirac came to his teacher and said, I have a paper concerning the quantum mechanical derivation of the statistics obeyed by electrons. Now, Fermi in Rome had independently arrived at the statistics, but Dirac had put it in a proper quantum mechanical foundation. So he brought his paper to Fowler and said, will you read it? If you think it is correct, will you please forward it to a suitable journal? And Fowler did that. That was in August 1926. Couple of months later, in November 1926, Fowler had applied these new ideas of Fermi and Dirac to save the highly condensed companion of Sirius in just 2 months. Now, it is remarkable, this is something that you may not know, and you may never be told this, that the very first application of the new rules of quantum physics discovered by Fermi and Dirac, we are all told that quantum physics has to do with the world of atoms and molecules. But the very first application was to a star, to the companion of Sirius. It was only a few months later that Pauli, who was 21 years old around that time, a student of Sommerfeld, applied the Fermi-Dirac statistics to explain the paramagnetism of metals. And Sommerfeld himself explained it to, used it to explain the properties of electrons in metals. So the very first application of Fermi-Dirac statistics was astonishingly to a macroscopic object, which was soon followed by these two fundamental papers. What did Fowler say? This paper by Fowler, written just 2 months after this new idea was, new paper was published by Dirac, in my opinion, ranks with Eddington's paper that I referred to yesterday as one of the most prescient statements in the entire history of astronomy. What Fowler said in our language today, he may not have used these words, as a star collapses and its density increases, at some stage, the rules of quantum mechanics will take over from classical physics. At high densities, a new pressure arises due to the combined effect of Heisenberg's uncertainty principle and Pauli's exclusion principle. This quantum pressure will at some stage or other stop gravitational collapse, and we will have a stable star, and the star will now be a quantum star. Absolutely remarkable statement. Now what, let's try to understand this a little better. You all know that Louis de Broglie started this revolution by saying that just as waves as particles, just as light is both a wave and a particle, he said massive particles are also waves. And the wavelength is given by Planck's constant divided by the momentum of the particle. Later on, Schrödinger came to the picture and said, each state of the particle represents a system of standing waves. So if I have a particle confined in a box, a one-dimensional box whose length is L, capital L, then the only standing waves you can have are psi 1, psi 2, psi 3, psi 4, etc. You will recognize them as the fundamental and the harmonics of a plucked string. That's all it is. There's no difference whatsoever. And today we know that these wave-like solutions satisfy a differential equation which we now have named after Erwin Schrödinger. Now let's solve Schrödinger equation for a particle in a one-dimensional box whose length is capital L. The first thing we discover, I mean, these are all things you learned in your 10th standard and so on, but I want you to transfer yourself back to the year 1926, when our understanding of quantum physics was incredibly primitive. So we know that the energy levels are quantized, E1, E2, E3. They are quantized simply because you can only have stationary waves which are standing waves. And the energy of the nth level, the expression is given over here. And like Fermi used to do, like I strongly would like to urge you to do, having written this, please also write, the energy of the nth level is proportional to n squared It is inversely proportional to 1 over L squared. Till you do that, it will not be etched in your mind. So smaller the box, larger is the energy. And please notice that the spacing between the energy level increases and does not decrease like in a Rydberg atom. Okay? That's why it is important to write these things. All right, now, again, I am telling all this based on our present understanding of quantum mechanics. You should go and read Fowler's paper. What did Heisenberg teach us around the same time? He said one cannot measure both the position and momentum of a particle with infinite precision. You are allowed to measure one of them very accurately, but at the expense of enormous error in the other. And then he stated his famous uncertainty principle that if delta P and delta X are the uncertainties in the measurement of position and momentum of the particle, then the product of these uncertainties should satisfy this inequality. So why is this important for us? What has it got to do with the price of fish, as they say? For the following very simple reason. Therefore, if we try to confine a particle to smaller and smaller volume, then the particle will acquire larger and larger momentum. So if I say that the particle is somewhere on this table, delta X is the length of this table, then the delta P is defined. But if I say, no, no, the particle is not there, it is inside my laptop, then delta X becomes much smaller, therefore delta P has to become much larger. Delta P cannot become much larger without P itself becoming very large. Therefore, if we try to confine a particle to smaller and smaller volume, then the particle will necessarily acquire larger and larger momenta, but this motion has nothing to do with heat. This motion has its origin in Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. And this motion is what we call a zero-point motion. It is like the motion of the electron in the oneness state of the hydrogen atom. Okay? It has to move, because if it didn't move, it will fall down to the nucleus. All right. So here is the same thing. One picture is worth 10,000 words, as the Chinese saying says. So if I squeeze a box, if I squeeze a star, then I'm defining the position of the electrons better and better. Therefore, the energies increase. So what Fowler said was that at the absolute zero of temperature, if I have particles in a one-dimensional box, I have to populate them as I have shown on the left in the diagram over there. I can put 2 electrons in each level, provided I'm careful to make sure that the spins are anti-parallel, because otherwise you would violate Pauli's principle. And you go on populating the energy level till you run out of electrons. And that highest level you call as the Fermi energy, E subscript F. The only way you can lower the energy further is by moving some of the electrons to the lower level. But if you did that, you will violate Pauli's exclusion principle. Therefore, the lowest possible energy configuration is what is shown on the left here. So let's say slightly differently. I have n electrons in volume V, and I am dealing with absolute zero of temperature. I'm dealing with absolute zero of temperature because I want to extract the essence of quantum physics without bringing in any thermal motion into the picture. So in quantum physics, energy levels are discrete. According to Pauli's principle, we can put only 2 electrons in each level, provided the spins are anti-parallel. And this is the crucial point that Fowler said for the very first time. Therefore, an electron gas has an enormous amount of energy even at the absolute zero of temperature. This is zero-point energy. And this energy becomes larger and larger as the box becomes smaller and smaller, or as the number of particles becomes larger and larger for a given size of box, because I just have to populate more and more energy level till I run out of electrons. Therefore, the maximum energy up to which all levels are occupied, above which all levels are empty, that maximum energy is defined by the size of the volume and the number of particles. Now, Fowler also said the following thing. These objects are now absolutely safe. Nothing can happen to them. Once the quantum mechanical pressure of the electron stops the collapse, the star would have found its ultimate peace. It has come to equilibrium with the laws of thermodynamics. Its specific heat is no longer negative. It can't do anything. Nothing can happen to it. There is no lurking danger. For the gaseous stars, Eddington was worried about one possible danger in the future, namely its nuclear reactor can fail. Here, I don't care. It has come to the end. It has found its graveyard. Why? Because it has been stopped by zero point energy, and you cannot extract zero point energy, because if you extracted zero point energy, you will violate Heisenberg's principle and Pauli's exclusion principle. Therefore, gravity has been stopped by zero point motion, not by heat, not motion due to heat. As Fowler said, the energy of the electron gas at t equal to zero is similar to the energy of an electron in the n equal to one level of the hydrogen atom. What he actually said in the paper was, he said, the white dwarf material can be likened to a gigantic atom or a molecule which is in the ground state. You can no more extract energy from the star than you can extract energy from an atom or molecule which is in the ground state. Same is true of electrons in energy, electron gas in a dense star, as is true for the electron in the lowest level of a hydrogen atom. Therefore, Fowler said, these white dwarf stars, like the companion of Sirius, have found their graveyard. They have found their ultimate peace. Now they are like pieces of a hot charcoal. There is some fossil heat. As they radiate, they'll become cooler and cooler and cooler, till finally the temperature will become the same as the temperature of the environment. At this stage in 1928, Chandrasekhar enters our story. He was a second year BSc student in Presidency College in Madras. And Sommerfeld, the year 1928 was the year Raman discovered Raman effect. So Sommerfeld had traveled all the way to Calcutta to see Raman effect for himself, because if it was true, then it was obviously very important. So some people wanted to be convinced that it was a true effect. So from Calcutta, he came to Madras for some sightseeing. And Chandrasekhar, who was 18 years old at the time, found out which hotel he was staying, and then went and knocked on his door. And then Sommerfeld said, come in. And then Chandrasekhar said, I'm very interested in physics. I'm studying physics and mathematics. So he said, what have you studied? He said, well, sir, I've read your book on atomic spectra. He said, no, 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 that's all changed now. That's all old story. There is a new story. What else have you studied? He said, I've studied statistical mechanics from Tolman's book. No, 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 that's all changed now. There is a great revolution taking place in physics. There are great discoveries made by Pauli, Heisenberg, Schrodinger, and others, which at that time had not found their way into books. And he was only in his second year of BSc at the time. So Sommerfeld had with him a proof, printer's proof in German, of his famous paper on application of Fermi-Dirac statistics to electrons in metals. So he told Chandrasekhar, if you like, do you know German? He said, yes, I know German. So he said, okay, then you can read from this and learn about new physics. So that is how Chandrasekhar first learned about the revolution that was sweeping in Europe and about the great discoveries made by Fermi, Dirac, Pauli, and others. And then he also discovered in the university library Fowler's paper, and which he instantly understood. But as a prize book on his first year BSc or high school, he had chosen Eddington's book on the internal constitution of stars, which he had read cover to cover. So he said, look, let me now construct models of these quantum objects, just as Eddington did. Very remarkable, bold objective for an 18-year-old, right? So what did he do? He knew that in a gaseous star, the gravitational force is balanced by a combined effect of gas and radiation. He said he also knew that the stability of the star is given by the equation of hydrostatic equilibrium, where dP by dr is minus gm rho over r squared, where the pressure is sum of gas pressure to be calculated from Boyle's law and radiation pressure get to be calculated from Stefan's law. He said, now look, let me repeat this whole thing that Eddington did for a quantum star, where gravity is now balanced not by Boyle's law pressure, not by radiation pressure, because I will deal with absolute zero of temperature, but by the pressure of the electrons. But Fowler hadn't talked of pressure of electrons. He was talking about putting electrons up to a certain level and so on, but the expression for pressure and so on were not there, nor could you go to Landau and Lipschitz or Kittel's book on solid state physics and copy this formula. These things didn't exist. So he had to do all these things. So let us now indulge in a little bit of elementary statistical mechanics. What is the difference between classical statistical mechanics and quantum statistical mechanics, which at that time did not exist except in the papers by Fermi and Dirac? And they were discussing matters of principle, and they were not talking about a star. In classical physics, as you know, momentum space, px, py, pz, the particles are in a box of volume V, can have any value. All momentum values are allowed. So if I ask which are the allowed values of momentum inside a sphere of a certain radius, the answer is every value is allowed. But then you can't do that in quantum physics. Let us consider a motion of a particle in one dimension whose length is capital L, length of the box is capital L. And what is plotted here is the momentum in the x direction. The point is, in classical physics, every point on this line is an allowed value of x momentum px. But Chandrasekhar knew that because of Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, which says delta x, delta px must be greater than the Planck's constant. Delta x, of course, is the length of the box L. Therefore, there is an uncertainty, an intrinsic uncertainty in the momentum whose value is h divided by L. Therefore, every point on this green line is not an allowed value of the momentum in quantum physics. It is like in a graph paper. You can only have in each grid one allowed momentum value. Therefore, momentum space is no longer continuous. It is made up of little Lego blocks that children play with. What is the size of a Lego block? H over L in this direction, H over L in this direction, and H over L in this direction, or H cubed divided by L cubed, which is same as H cubed divided by the volume. So momentum space is built up of these Lego blocks. The size of the Lego block is determined by Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. Now let us ask, all momentum space all momentum values up to a certain maximum value, which is PF for Fermi momentum are occupied. Remember, all energies are occupied up to a certain energy, which we call as the Fermi energy. P squared by 2m, that P is now we call as the Fermi momentum. So in this picture, all momentum states inside the sphere are occupied, and all momentum states outside the sphere are unoccupied at absolute zero of temperature. What is the volume of the sphere? 4 pi by 3 PF cube. We also know that in each Lego block, we can put 2 electrons. Very good. So here is a summary once again. At absolute zero, all momentum states up to the Fermi momentum PF are occupied, and all states outside are empty. Now let's calculate this Fermi momentum. Well, how many Lego blocks are there inside the sphere? The volume of the sphere is 4 pi by 3 PF cube. The volume of each block is h cube divided by the volume. But I can put 2 particles in each Lego block. Therefore, the number of particles capital N inside that sphere is number of occupied blocks multiplied by 2. So it is 2v by h cubed, 4 pi by 3 pf cubed. Okay? So I can solve this equation for pf in terms of the number of particles and the volume v, which is what I have written here. The Fermi momentum pf is proportional to density to the power 1 by 3. So this should be etched in your mind. Where did this 1 by 3 come from? From Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. Please also note that this value of this momentum is independent of the mass of the particle, which does not enter that formula. Because the mass of the particle, whether it's electron or a proton or a neutron, is immaterial, because we are dealing with Heisenberg's principle. This is important for our story now, okay? Fine. So what I'm saying is, if I compress the box, then in momentum space, the occupied sphere will become larger and larger. That is as Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. Now let's calculate the Fermi energy. In Newtonian mechanics, energy is p squared by 2m. Therefore, the Fermi energy is pf squared by 2m. Therefore, the Fermi energy is proportional to density to the power 2 by 3. Power 2 by 3 comes because pf squared is equal to ef. But please notice that in Newtonian mechanics, the mass of the particle does enter the Fermi energy. It doesn't enter the Fermi momentum, but it enters the Fermi energy. Therefore, although the electron and proton and neutron will have the same Fermi momentum, they will have different Fermi energy. The level up to which their energy bucket is filled will be different. And that is very important for the story that I'm going to tell you. So here is the summary. So as I compress a box, Fermi momentum increases as density to the power 1 by 3. Fermi energy increases as density to the power 2 by 3. Now let's calculate the pressure of this gas like Chandrasekhar did. Let's remind ourselves how we calculated the pressure of a classical gas, Boyle's law. The first lecture I said the pressure is 2 by 3 internal energy per unit volume. The internal energy is the average energy of the particles multiplied by the total number of particles, which is n into 3 by 2. And therefore, the pressure is nkT, which is Boyle's law. And this pressure, of course, goes to zero at the absolute zero of temperature, because all motion by virtue of heat ceases at absolute zero of temperature. Now let's use the same principle to calculate the pressure of an electron gas at absolute zero of temperature. We'll use the same equation. The pressure is 2 by 3 internal energy per unit volume. Now, the internal energy is the average energy of the particles multiplied by the total number of particles. Now, what is the average energy of the particle? If you look at a book like Kittel's Introductory Solid-State Physics or more sophisticated books like Landau and Lipschitz, it'll be done for you. But let's do a poor man's thing. Suppose you are like Donald Trump, you own a big skyscraper. You're the landlord collecting rent. Somebody asks you, tax man asks you, what is the average rent? You don't remember, but you know what the guy in the penthouse is paying. So the average rent will be some fraction. It may be half, it may be two-thirds, it may be three-quarters, but it is a fraction, right? We are not bothered about this fraction, as long as you can do an honest calculation, which I want to urge you to do, right? So that fraction is dot, dot, dot inside a bracket. Therefore, the internal energy of the electron gas at absolute zero of temperature is the number of particles multiplied by a fraction of the Fermi energy, and therefore, the pressure of the electron gas is proportional to density to the power 5 by 3. Where did 5 by 3 come from? N by V, N by V to the power 2 by 3. Yeah? So this should be in your mind forever. The pressure of a non-relativistic Fermi gas is proportional to density to the power 5 by 3. And this pressure is known in the literature as degeneracy pressure, that because I populated all levels up to a certain level and all levels are empty. Now, let us see how Chandrasekhar constructed his theory of white dwarfs. This is not the language that he used in his paper, but I choose to describe it like this. dP by dr is minus gm rho over r squared. The only thing different between Eddington's theory and Chandrasekhar's theory is P is now the pressure due to electrons. It's a quantum mechanical pressure, which is proportional to some constant K1, which he calculated. He calculated this proportionality constant, which I'm calling as K1, times density to the power 5 by 3. Now, don't be confused. That density was number density N. Because I'm dealing with gravity, I'm converting it to a mass density by multiplying by mass of the particle, dividing by the mass of the particle. Okay, so rho, because the equation of hydrostatic equilibrium, I'm not dealing with N, but I'm dealing with rho. So the degeneracy pressure is K1 rho to the power 5 by 3. Now, this is the first order differential equation, which Chandrasekhar knew how to solve. It has to be solved numerically. It cannot be solved analytically. Please remember, those days there were no computers, there were no calculators, there was only log tables. So you use log tables to integrate this differential equation. And this is the result that he found. He found that the radius of the star is inversely proportional to the cube root of the mass. So, one picture is worth 10,000 words. So let's plot this thing. What is plotted on the y-axis is the radius of this quantum star. X-axis is the mass of the quantum star, different stars with different masses. And this mass-radius relationship is shown as that yellow line. R is proportional to m to the power minus 1 by 3. He also calculated in an exact manner that the average density of the star is proportional to square of the mass, and the central density, obviously denser at the central density is 6 times the average density. These are exact results from his theory. But he did one step further. Why do you want to do all these things? You know, hypothetical, theoretical calculation? No, he was interested in the companion of Sirius. At that time, there were only 3 such objects known in the galaxy. The companion of Sirius, between 1925 and 28, 2 more objects were discovered. Astronomers had estimated their mass and radius. So his mass radius relationship, if you had an object whose mass was mass of the sun, then its radius would be 10,000 kilometers, which fitted excellently with all the three known objects. I already told you the companion of Sirius had a mass of roughly the solar mass, and experimentally Walter Adams had demonstrated that its radius is 10,000 kilometers. So this theory of Chandrasekhar was spectacularly successful. So to summarize, he showed stars of all mass will ultimately find peace as quantum stars in which they are supported by the pressure of the electrons. And then he applied for a scholarship, which he got, to study with Ralph Fowler in Cambridge. And in July 1930, he set sail to England. He went to Bombay and then got a ship from Bombay to London. And during the voyage, he made a very remarkable discovery. And now that discovery is at the base of the present revolution in astronomy. So he was 18 and a half years old, or 19 years old at the time. As you know, he got the Nobel Prize for this discovery. And there is a tendency, particularly in our country, to exaggerate the significance of a Nobel Prize. Of course, it's not something that I'm likely to get, but then we're not talking about me, right? But then it'll be grossly unfair to think of Chandrasekhar in terms of a Nobel laureate, because as it evolved, as his life evolved, yes, the very first thing he did got him a Nobel Prize. It was somebody else's stupidity. They waited for 53 years to give him the Nobel Prize. But then he went on and on and on. And then by the time he quit at the age of 85, people realized that the very best work he did was the very last work at the age of 85. So his starting point was a Nobel Prize winning discovery. So Chandrasekhar shouldn't be thought of this way. And as we will see in the end of this lecture, I'll put in proper perspective the importance of this discovery. So I mean it when I say that this discovery, of course it deserves the Nobel Prize, but far more important is that discovery is at the base of the revolution that we are witnessing in astrophysics today. Okay, what he discovered was that his earlier conclusion is not correct. The really massive white dwarfs will collapse. How did he arrive at this conclusion? He asked himself, have I done everything right sitting in Madras? He came to the conclusion, mathematically, I've done everything absolutely correct. But he said, let me look at the physics. Have I made some assumption which cannot be rigorously justified? And then he found a point which he could not justify. And that was the following. You remember, this is the result he had obtained in Madras. And he knew that as you go to more and more massive stars, they are smaller and smaller. They are smaller and smaller because, unlike the weight in the market, 1 kilogram is this big, 2 kilograms is this big, 20 kilograms is this big. Here, as the mass increases, the radius decreases. So as you go to more and more massive stars, which are denser and denser and denser, average density is proportional to square of the mass, the Fermi momentum will go on increasing. At some value of the mass, so many grams, that momentum will become comparable to mass of the particle multiplied by the speed of light. At which point, special relativity becomes important. He had not taken into account special relativity in his derivation in Madras. He had assumed. Why he had not taken into account? So let us briefly discuss a relativistic Fermi gas. Fermi momentum, of course, mass of the particle does not come in, and Fermi momentum is valid regardless of relativity because it is based on Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. But let's look at the Fermi energy. He had assumed that the Fermi energy is equal to Pf squared divided by 2m. Now, this is true only if the particles are moving slowly compared to the speed of light. When the particles are moving at speed comparable to the speed of light, we know that the real relation, Einstein taught us this in 1905, E squared is m squared c to the power 4 plus p squared c squared. Now, he didn't know how to take this into account because, as I said, there were no calculators, let alone computers. But he said, let me take the case of an extremely relativistic gas where the particles are moving very nearly at the speed of light. Then I can drop the first term compared to the second term. Then the energy of the particle is of the order of p times c. The momentum of a photon is h nu by c, so E is equal to h nu. So we know that in the extreme relativistic case, the energy and momentum are linearly related, and it is not a quadratic relation as in Newtonian mechanics. This changes everything. It changes everything because now the Fermi energy on the left is not Pf squared divided by 2m, it's simply Pf multiplied by c. Therefore, the Fermi energy is once again proportional to density to the power 1 by 3 and not 2 by 3. Please also notice that the Fermi energy of the ultra-relativistic particle does not depend on the mass of the particle. Previously, mass came in the denominator. This is as it should be. What do we mean when we say a particle is ultra-relativistic? What we mean is its kinetic energy is much greater than the rest mass energy. In the world we live in, rest mass energy is much more important than kinetic energy, which is the Newtonian regime. So, let's calculate the total energy of the gas. Total energy of the gas is proportional to EF to the power 4. EF is proportional to density to the power 1 by 3. Therefore, the total energy of an relativistic electron gas at the absolute zero of temperature is proportional to density to the power 4 by 3. Therefore, the pressure, which is total energy divided by the volume multiplied by 1 by 3, is proportional to density to the power 4 by 3 and not 5 by 3. And you notice that the pressure of a relativistic electron gas does not depend on the mass of the particle. And indeed, it should not depend on the mass of the particle. That's what we mean by saying a particle is ultra-relativistic. I'm surprised that you haven't screamed and said, why is the total energy proportional to EF to the power 4? Well, that's rather simple. Let me tell you that. If I want to calculate the total energy, I have to integrate the energy of the particle. The probability that a particle has an energy between E and E plus dE, and the number of particles with energy E and E plus dE. This is, of course, the Fermi-Dirac distribution, and this is the density of states. Now, at absolute zero of temperature, the probability that the particle is occupied is 1, and this integral goes only from 0 to EF and not 0 to infinity. What about the density of states? If you remember from Maxwell-Boltzmann statistics, GFP is 4 pi p squared dp. Where does this come from? What is the number of momentum states between p and p plus dp? It is a shell of the sphere of radius p and thickness dp, which is 4 pi p squared dp. If you now convert this to E, then this will be square root of 2m cube, verify it, square root of E dE in Newton, if E is p squared by 2m, in special relativity, this will be simply E squared dE, because P and E are linearly related. So I will have this density of states becomes E squared dE, integral of E cubed is E to the power 4, and the upper limit is E to the power, EF to the power 4. So that's where it comes from, okay? Fine, so now convince yourself, do this slowly and correctly, and convince yourself that is correct. Very good. So what Chandrasekhar did in the boat is that now let me integrate the equation of hydrostatic equilibrium using this equation of state, dependence of pressure on density. So to summarize, the non-relativistic expression for degeneracy pressure is that it is proportional to density to the power 5 by 3, whereas for a relativistic electron gas, it is density to the power 4 by 3. Now, I would like you today to convince yourself that you know how to calculate this in detail, and all these proportionality constant pi and numbers and everything should be there. And if you do this, repeat it for relativistic gas, you will have that expression. But the important thing is don't lose track of the fact that this is proportional to density to the power 5 by 3, 4 by 3 over here. So what Chandrasekhar did on the boat, he didn't have any books or anything, but he had his log tables and that's all. He said, let me now integrate the equation of hydrostatic equilibrium. This is what he had done in Madras, remember? If E is p squared over 2m, which is non-relativistic electron gas, the equation of, the expression for the pressure is density to the power 5 by 3, and that gave him this mass radius relation. So he said, now let me repeat this with E is equal to p times c, which will give me an expression for the degeneracy pressure as density to the power 4 by 3. The constant in front is different. It's called K2 now. He knew how to integrate this exactly. He didn't even need the log tables. Because with this power, it's one of the differential equations which can be solved exactly. And you know what he got? A very remarkable result. He found that this star has a mass but no radius. dP by dr is equal to minus gm rho over r squared. Radius simply cancelled out from left-hand side and right-hand side. Convince yourself, dP by dr, for p put rho to the power 4 by 3, rho is m over r cubed. Do scaling argument, you'll find r cancels out. But the star has a mass. And what is that mass? That is a mass. It is our good old expression, hc by g to the power 3/2, 1 over mp squared. But this time, it's multiplied by 0.197. I've written it as 0.197. It is really pi to the power 4 by 916, which is a Riemann zeta integral. It's one of the integrals. Okay, if you look in the table of integrals, you find it's pi to the power 4 by 916 or something like that, which approximately is 0.197. This, you will remember, is the combination of fundamental constants with the dimension of mass in Eddington's theory. It is the same combination. But this value was 29.2 solar mass, but now that is multiplied by 0.197. But there is one other thing here, which is 1 over mu squared, which wasn't there before. Now, what is mu? Mu is what the physicists call as a mean molecular weight. In other words, mu times mp is the mass per electron. Okay, let's try to understand this. It's a very simple but extremely important contribution. You take hydrogen, for every electron, there is only one. Please remember, it is the electrons that supply pressure. But gravity doesn't talk to the electrons. Gravity only talks to the protons, because gravitational force on the electron is 2,000 times less. Okay, so the question is, for gravity, you want to know how many nuclear particles are there. For pressure, you want to know how many electrons are there. So if I have n electrons in an atom, how many particles are there in the nuclei? 2n. Because you take any element in the periodic table, just leave out hydrogen. For every element from hydrogen to uranium, A over Z is approximately 2. Right? So that's what the chemists call as the mean molecular weight. So mu is 2, unless you are dealing with hydrogen. We know we cannot be dealing with hydrogen because hydrogen has been converted to helium. It may have been converted to heavier things also, but there isn't any hydrogen in the center. Right? So it is safe to assume mu is 2. Now if I put mu is equal to 2, then the value of this mass is 1.4 times the mass of the sun. So what is this mass we are talking about? This is the mass of an ultra-relativistic star. It has no radius, but it has a mass. And that mass is determined by the combination of fundamental constants, which are all measured in the laboratory, and no astronomical input goes into this formula. So our physicists in our cloud-bound planet, who know only the laws of physics and constants measured in the laboratory, are able to predict uniquely what the mass of such a star ought to be. Previously, they said it would be of the order of 29 times the mass of the sun. But now they are saying it will have this mass and nothing else. Well, you'll say, but this is an oversimplification, because E is not P squared by 2m, but nor is E P times C. E is square root of m squared c to the power 4 plus p squared c squared. Now that is a more complicated differential equation. So when he went to Cambridge, he gave Fowler two papers. One is the paper he had written in Madras, which is the mass-radius relation of a non-relativistic star. Fowler read it and said, excellent, and said, I'll send it for publication. But the second paper of a star which has a mass but no radius, he didn't know what to make out of it. So he sent it to a very distinguished astronomer by name Milne. He said, I don't know what to make of this result. So Fowler said, just keep it in your drawer till we really understand what it is. But Chandrasekhar knew he had not made any mistake. He knew this result must be correct. But he knew if he sent it to a journal behind his professor's back, the journal is bound to ask him or somebody else, right? So he sent it to an American journal, secretly. He sent it to the Astrophysical Journal, which he then made a world's most famous journal of astronomy by becoming its editor for 22 years later on. That's a later story. And Astrophysical Journal published this paper. But then he settled down, because this was not his thesis work. Okay, his thesis work was in the stellar atmospheres. But after he finished his thesis, he said, let me now, don't make that assumption, use the full expression for energy and momentum and integrate that equation. It was very hard, there were no calculators and so on. It took him a year to do that with log tables. And today you people will do it in about 2 minutes or so. You can probably do it with your mobile phone. But this is what he found. For sufficiently low mass, the exact theory, which is the red curve, agreed exactly with the non-relativistic Newtonian theory, which he had before, which is not surprising. Because low mass white dwarfs, the density is low, therefore Newtonian mechanics is perfectly okay. But as the mass of the star increased more and more, this red curve deviated significantly from the yellow dash curve, and when it reached this critical mass of 1.4 solar mass, it took a nosedive and the radius went to zero. Then it became clear what was actually happening, a gravitational collapse. Now this mass is now known as the Chandrasekhar limit and plays a very fundamental role in contemporary astrophysics, because the formation of neutron stars and black holes is crucially related with the existence of this mass limit. And to me, it's one of the most beautiful formulae in all of physics. You're saying, here is a mass of a star. Such a star can have this and only this mass, and that mass is determined uniquely by the combination of fundamental constants. Cube of the Planck mass divided by the square of the proton mass. So stars more massive than 1.4 times the mass of the sun cannot be supported by quantum mechanical pressure, and therefore they will collapse. Therefore, not all stars will find their peace as quantum stars. If their mass is more than 1.4 times the mass of the sun, then they are doomed, like Eddington feared in 1925. Now, this picture is a very small portion of the sky seen with the Hubble Space Telescope. Just a few fraction of a degree by fraction of a degree in the sky, and every single object you see here is a white dwarf. Every single object you see here is a white dwarf. When Chandrasekhar wrote his paper, only three were known. This is a small number, I mean small area. Now, how does the nature make white dwarfs? Nature doesn't make white dwarfs, nature makes stars. Now, what we know is the following. If I plot on the y-axis the number of stars whose mass is m as a function of the mass of the star, then you find that you have a power law. This is an observationally determined curve. It's a steep power law. That means the fraction of stars with large mass is very small compared to the fraction of stars with low mass. It is these low mass stars that will become white dwarfs, as we will see. Therefore, roughly 90% of all the stars that were formed in our galaxy in the last 10 billion years have all ended their lives as white dwarfs, because that's where the maximum number were. It's not just that. Roughly 90% of the stars that are presently shining will also end up as white dwarfs. Therefore, the matter that finds itself trapped in a star as a low mass star is never released. It is trapped forever. As we will see, it is only the more massive stars that explode and return the mass. That's why the Earth is made up of iron and heavy elements. We are made from the debris of a star that exploded. And that was not the first generation star. That might have been the 1,000th generation star. So there's been a lot of recycling going on. But I want you to appreciate that the galaxy and all galaxies, the overwhelming majority of the population are white dwarfs. And if 90% of all the stars that were ever formed in the galaxy ended up as white dwarfs, lot of them will be billions of years old. What happens to a white dwarf in billions of years? It'll get cooler and cooler and cooler, because the original heat which is trapped takes a long time to come out, and therefore temperature will come down. We have discovered white dwarfs whose temperature is as low as 3,000, 4,000 Kelvin. When they are formed, their temperature is several hundreds of thousands of degrees, because you're talking of the extremely dense core. Okay? Now you'll say, how can I think of a star at hundreds of thousands of degrees as at absolute zero of temperature? you think of them as very cold object. Hot or cold have no meaning in physics. You have to compare it. What you have to compare are KT and the Fermi energy. Fermi energy is enormous compared to KT, even if T is 100,000 degrees. Okay? So 100,000 degrees is T equal to zero for our purpose, right? Okay. Now let's see what is happening deep inside the star. So here's a little bit of astrostellar astrophysics for you, and I will only point out the essential physics. We are going to leave out all the details, let alone the derivations. So I have shown a small portion of the star. The star is 1,000,000 kilometers in radius, going way outside. Deep in the center, we have a helium core. This helium core is formed. We didn't know at that time, but we know after 1938, Hans Bethe's paper, that helium was formed by converting hydrogen to helium. Surrounding that helium core, hydrogen is still being converted to helium because what you need is very high temperature, so the furnace is still burning, converting hydrogen to helium. So if you are now to go to the center of the sun, what you'll find is a tiny helium core. Surrounding that, there'll be hydrogen being converted to helium, and the rest of the star, nothing is happening. It's just hydrogen. Now let's pursue this story. I'm now trying to explain to you how nature forms white dwarfs. Now the thing is this fusion reaction going to continue or is it going to end, to burn or not to burn? Now, the helium core, when it forms, is inert because its temperature is only 15 million degrees. And I already said the other day that to fuse two helium nuclei, I need a temperature of 100 million Kelvin. I haven't reached 100 million Kelvin, so that helium remains as helium, it's inert. Now, whether or not the nuclear reaction proceeds to the next stage depends on whether the contracting core heats up to the required temperature or not. 100 million, 500 million, 10 to the power 9, 10 to the power 10, which was the last slide of the previous lecture. This, in turn, will be determined by whether the core obeys ideal gas equation of state or Fermi-Dirac statistics. Now, why? Here is an interesting piece of physics for you to understand. So let's look at this picture. I have a star whose core, which is that blue smaller circle, is inert, and that core is contracting because gravity is squeezing it, because in the equation of hydrostatic equilibrium, there is no pressure other than the pressure due to the fossil heat. The question is, when the core contracts, is it going to become hotter or not? And the answer is, it will become hotter. Your cycle pump, as you press it, becomes hotter and hotter. But it is only true if the gas obeys Boyle's law. And here is an exercise for you, those of you who like derivations, very elementary, should not take more than about 200 seconds. Convince yourself the change in the central temperature dT by dT will be 1 by 3 d rho by rho. And I have used Boyle's law. I'm not using anything else. Okay? So be sure you know how to calculate this. Right? But whether or not you know how to calculate it, the message is if I compress a classical gas, it will get hotter. But if this gas in the core is not obeying classical statistics, but is obeying Fermi-Dirac statistics, then it will not heat up. Because when I compress a degenerate gas, its Fermi energy will become even larger, EF will become even larger than KT. So effectively, let's try to understand this. What do we mean when we say Yeah, you must be very clear in your mind about the following. I have an energy bucket, let's take a one-dimensional gas, and all the states up to the Fermi energy are occupied, and KT is a very small amount. That's because KT is much less than EF. That is the condition for the gas to be quantum mechanical. What we are saying is, if I heat this energy bucket, then it is only the electrons which are here which can sort of go up. And having gone up, they'll behave like a classical gas. But a very small fraction will go up, because you can't take something from the bottom of the bucket and take it to the top, because the energy you have is only a very small amount, KT. Now, if this bucket now, instead of being like that, if this bucket becomes much deeper, EF is much larger now. Why is EF much larger? Because I have compressed this degenerate core. Even if KT increases a little bit, EF has increased so enormously, if anything, it's even colder now. Okay? So it is a correct inference that if I compress a degenerate gas, the temperature will not go up significantly. Therefore, whether the stellar drama ends or continues is related to whether the core obeys classical statistics or quantum statistics. Let's therefore summarize. You must be very clear in your mind about this. You say a system is classical if KBT is much greater than EF. You say a system is quantum if EF is very much greater than KT. It's not a question of small or large, okay? It's a comparison always. What do we mean by these two relations? What we mean is the motion due to heat more important or less important compared to the motion due to Heisenberg's uncertainty principle? That's really what we are saying. The transition from an ideal gas to degenerate gas is roughly when EF is of the order of KBT, roughly of the order of KBT. All right, now let's look at the fate of a contracting core. We already said this, right? Now what I'm saying now, new, is that in low mass stars like the Sun, and also intermediate stars, mass is about 2 times the mass of the Sun, 3 times the mass of the Sun, and so on, the core will become degenerate as it contracts. In other words, if you went and looked at the center of the Sun, not only you will find helium, you will find that helium to be a degenerate core. Okay. But if you go to massive stars, something which is 10 times the mass of the Sun or 20 times the mass of the Sun, at the corresponding age, you'll find that helium is still classical. Why? We'll come to that. That is due to one of Chandrasekhar's most profound discoveries. So let's try to understand the behavior of a classical gas and a quantum gas in this diagram. What is plotted on the y-axis is the logarithm of the temperature of the gas. What is plotted on the x-axis is the logarithm of the density of the gas. At low densities and high temperatures, the gas is classical. At high densities, the gas is quantum mechanical or degenerate. What is the mathematical criterion? The mathematical criterion is on the left of the sloping line, sloping rectangular box, KT is much greater than EF. On the right, EF is much greater than KT. And what is this rectangular box which separates the classical regime from the quantum regime? It is when KT is equal to EF. KT is equal to EF. EF is proportional to density to the power 2/3. Therefore, in a log-log plot, it will have a slope of 2/3. If I'm dealing with a relativistic gas, EF is proportional to density to the power 1/3. Therefore, it'll have a slope of 1/3, okay? That's why this rectangular box is tilted over, its slope is 1/3. So you've understood. So as I heat the gas, as I increase the density of the gas, its temperature will go up. The question is it still going to remain on the left or right? So here is a star, a low mass star, the core of it. As I increase its density, its temperature increases, but at some density, the gas becomes quantum mechanical. It becomes degenerate. And then, of course, it has a different behavior and it becomes a white dwarf. Now, suppose we go to a little more massive star. I'm telling you the summary in pictorial form. These are pictures drawn by me of the results we have obtained during the last 50 years due to detailed computer evolution of stars. Try to summarize them in terms of very simple pictures. So if I go to a slightly more massive star, the behavior will still be the same. The density at which the star becomes quantum mechanical will be somewhat higher now. Log rho is about 4. But then if I go to a really massive star, you find as I heat the gas, as I make the gas denser and denser, its temperature goes on increasing, it remains classical forever and ever. This is the result of, computer calculations. But you say, well, computer, you can't believe something just because the computer results, so that there must be a better understanding, at least a posteriori, at least after the fact, you must have an understanding. Well, it turns out, as we will discuss, the understanding was provided way back in 1932, before Chandrasekhar even derived the exact result. He wrote another paper, which to me was his most profound paper from that period. I'll tell you about that. So let's continue with the story and come back to this. Why is this peculiar difference between the behavior of massive stars? It remains classical, and therefore, as it compresses, it becomes hotter and hotter and hotter. Therefore, the curtain of the stellar drama comes down, goes up again, helium is converted to carbon, comes down, carbon gets hotter, and it goes up again till you come to iron, and then the formation of either a neutron star or a black hole. Why is this so? You'll see. Very beautiful result, very simple result. But to me, it's staggering that a 20-year-old boy discovered it a long time ago. So in low mass stars, this is just a summary of those pictures. Once again, so in low mass stars like the Sun, the helium core will be inert and degenerate. Degenerate meaning it will be obeying Fermi-Dirac statistics. And since there is no energy generation in the core will contract. Now, here is where an interesting thing happens. As the core contracts, the gravitational potential energy, Gm squared by R, will increase because R is becoming smaller and smaller. Right? Potential energy is increasing. Potential energy is negative. So this energy which is released will go to distending the star. In other words, as the core compresses, the star will expand. In order for the star to expand, it has to work against gravity, which causes energy. Where is this energy coming from? The core is giving you the energy. This is a very important phenomenon. It goes under the name of gravothermal catastrophe. It happens again and again and again in so many systems. This was first discovered by Chandrasekhar in the context of globular clusters of stars in the mid-1930s. But then you encounter this all the time. So let's try to understand the basic physics. What we are saying is, when the core of the star is contracting, the envelope of the star will expand. So this picture tells you everything. Okay? So if you're brave enough, you can put your equations and convince yourself. So our star, in the left is our star. Most of it is hydrogen, uninteresting. In the center, there is a helium core which is degenerate and contracting. There is a thin layer in which hydrogen is still being converted to helium, otherwise the star wouldn't be shining. As the core is compressing, the star expands. The star becomes a giant. Its radius will become 50 million kilometers from 1 million kilometers. It'll also become red. It will become red for a very simple reason. The luminosity of an object is 4 pi r squared multiplied by sigma t to the power 4. Sigma t to the power 4 is the energy radiated per unit area per unit time. The total area is 4 pi r squared. That luminosity is being generated here. Here, 4 pi r squared sigma t to the power 4 will determine the temperature of the star. Here, 4 pi r squared sigma t to the power 4 will determine the temperature of the surface of this red giant. Since r is large, t has to be small. So as I cool the black body from Weyl's displacement law, the sun, which is looking yellow, if the sun expands, the surface will be cooler, it'll look red. That's why a red giant looks red. Sun looks yellow. When it becomes a white dwarf, it is white, which means there's more blue. The temperature is even higher. So I understand. So that's what a red giant star is. A red giant star also becomes highly convective, and I don't have time to go into it. What I mean is, equation of hydrostatic equilibrium is broken in most of the star. Star is, that is, the material from below comes to the top, like in atmosphere, like day before yesterday when we had thunderstorm, that's what is happening. Why is there hail? Water droplets are taken to very great height, it freezes, comes down, it is coated by water, goes up again, so the ice grows in size. Finally, when it reaches a critical size, it falls down. That's what hail is, right? So now, let's continue with this story. Although the helium core is degenerate, and therefore it will not heat up due to compression, please remember it is surrounded by a furnace which is burning. So that heat will heat up the core. Not necessarily heat it generates by itself, but the heat of the surrounding. So slowly the helium core will heat up. But at some stage, the helium core will reach a temperature of 10 to the power 8 Kelvin, when helium can fuse with helium to form carbon. So the curtain goes up again. But when it does, all hell breaks loose. All hell breaks loose because of the following reason. Previously, I said the sun doesn't blow itself apart because there is a safety valve. If the core generates more energy, it becomes hotter. If it becomes hotter, the pressure will become larger. Boyle's law P is rho kT. Therefore, the core will expand and cool, and there is a safety valve. But now look, we are dealing with a degenerate core, obeying Fermi-Dirac statistics. As the core gets hotter, the pressure remains the same. Because pressure has nothing to do with heat. KT is very small compared to EF. Pressure is determined by density to the power, whatever it is, 4 by 3 or 5 by 3, depending on whether you're non-relativistic or relativistic. And because it's hotter, it will generate more energy. Please remember, the tunneling probability is an exponential probability. As the height of the barrier decreases, remember square root of V minus E, as E increases, because there is a minus sign outside, as E increases, tunneling probability increases. Therefore, the fusion reaction will go faster and faster. So the core will become even hotter, but the pressure will remain the same. What is the temperature dependence of nuclear reaction? The temperature dependence of the nuclear reaction depends upon, remember, the height of the potential barrier is Z1, Z2 million electron volt. So if you now look at this very carefully, you'll find that in book, the temperature dependence of the nuclear reaction is T to the power 40. Then in the next stage is T to the power 140. So if I change T by a very small amount, the energy you generate increases as T to the power very large number. And so finally, you have a bomb. What is a bomb? It's a positive feedback instead of a negative feedback. There is no safety valve. As it generates more and more energy, at some stage, it will have enough energy to blow up out the whole star. And the story ends there. Luckily, at this stage, the story doesn't end there. Because there is a helium bomb now. The helium is fusing, it's a bomb. But the bomb is expanding. As it is expanding, but the bomb is getting hotter and hotter, so KT is increasing. At some stage, KT will become comparable to EF, and the gas once again becomes classical, and the safety valve comes in. It's like somebody in a reactor is turned off the switch, and before it blows itself, he realizes and turns on the switch. But there is no guarantee that you'll have enough time to do that. In the case of helium being converted to carbon, there is enough time for the star to retrieve itself. But if it were to do this in the carbon stage, that happens so fast, that temperature to the power 140, it is a bomb. The whole star will blow itself apart. Okay, so let's stick with this low mass stars. I'm discussing stars like the Sun. So in stars like the Sun, the helium bomb will get hotter and hotter, and therefore the safety valve will once again turn on, because KT will once again become comparable to EF, and KT will become larger than EF, and the star will once again be classical. So what will now happen? The core will expand. As the core expands, the star will contract, opposite of before. Where did this get this energy to expand? The star is compressing, so gm squared by r for the whole star is being released. Okay, so convince yourself. So every time you see a red star in the sky, it's beautiful. You know what is happening right in the core. You know there is a core which is contracting. And you know that it is a helium core which is contracting. How do you know it's a helium core and not a carbon core? Well, at some stage, the helium will fuse, and what is the result of that fusion? Carbon. So you'll now have a carbon core, and that carbon core will once again be degenerate, and because the core is inert, it'll contract, and the gravitational energy released this time will be very much more, because the helium core was this big, carbon core is this big, gm squared by r is even more. So the star will expand even more. So it will expand not to just 50 times the radius of the Sun, but 300 times the radius of the Sun. And what you have is a red supergiant stars. You can see a lot of them in the sky. Go and look. Well, you know, next time you look at the sky, which is very difficult in a city like Bangalore because of light pollution, but then once in a while, when there is a power outage or something like that, when you look at the stars, try to look at the colors. Some will be, most will be yellowish or whitish. And you'll see red stars very, very easily. So when you see a red supergiant, what you're seeing is a contracting carbon core. And so when the Sun becomes a red supergiant, it'll swallow us, because the distance between the Earth and the Sun is 150 solar radius. The Sun will become much larger than this. It will swallow even Mars. And at that stage, a white dwarf is born. Remember, we are discussing how nature produces white dwarfs. What happens is, this supergiant star, for reasons which we will not discuss, it will go into detailed astrophysics, becomes pulsationally unstable. It begins vibrating periodically. And it is so big that the outer layers are not gravitationally that strongly bound to the star, because it's 300 times the radius, the star, original star. And then the whole of the outer envelope, like smoke ring, poof, it just goes off. And what remains is only the core of the star. So here is a supergiant star which has shed the layers. And what you see at the center is the degenerate carbon core. Initially, it'll be white hot, and then over billions of years, that'll get cooler and cooler and cooler. So this is how we see this all the time. You go to Hubble telescope site and look for, these are called planetary nebulae, because it sounds like a sun surrounded by planets. So if you type planetary nebula, you'll see wonderful images. These are beautiful to look at. These are red supergiants, just shed. And that is a, so that's how nature makes white dwarfs. Now, after billions of years, when the temperature of the white dwarf drops to a few thousand Kelvin, it will solidify. Some stage, the temperature becomes less than the melting temperature, and it'll become a solid. And what is it made of mostly? Carbon. A little bit of oxygen will be there. And people have calculated very hard, good solid-state physicists, reliable people, and they say that it will crystallize into diamond structure. What is this based on? If you now look at the phase diagram of carbon, carbon comes in many allotropic forms: graphite, graphene, Buckminster Fuller balls, right? All these things, and diamond. So if you go to very high pressure, which is the y-axis, you find that the most stable, the lowest energy configuration is diamond. We already have found half a dozen white dwarfs whose interior is almost certainly a solid. We know that from vibrations of those stars, earthquakes, starquakes. From star earthquakes, you know whether the interior is liquid or solid. In the same way, you can deduce about white dwarf. So we at least have three or four candidates, but we know it is solid. We don't know if it's diamond. But the conjecture is it will be diamond. So the largest diamond in the world is about some 400 carats. I've seen that in Washington Smithsonian Museum. Piece of stone about that big. This is 10 to the power 33 grams. And there are billions and billions of them in our own galaxy, let alone other galaxies. So, to conclude the story, what we now understand through 50 years of very hard work, like I said yesterday, stars up to 9 solar mass end their lives as white dwarfs. The very, very low mass ones, less than half a solar mass, end up as helium white dwarfs. But the majority of white dwarfs in the sky are carbon white dwarfs with a little bit of oxygen. That forms when carbon is formed. If you look at it in detail, the nuclear physics, some oxygen is also formed. But what we said was that these diamonds are not forever. If the mass of this diamond exceeds 1.4 times the mass of the sun, they will collapse. Now, let's end by thinking a little bit about this Chandrasekhar limit. Place his discovery in proper perspective, not view it in terms of a Nobel Prize. Now, I think it is very fair to say, accurate to say, that this extraordinary discovery by a 19-year-old boy revolutionized our view of the heavens. We did not realize that at that time. And that had to wait till the 1970s. That's why the Nobel Prize was given only in 1983, because observational evidence came only with the discovery of neutron stars and so on, right? Because this discovery signaled gravitational collapse of massive stars. Now, why is that important? Of course, this soon led to the notion of neutron stars, supernova explosions, which is the subject of the next lecture, And then, of course, the notion of black holes. Now that, of course, signifies the contemporary theme of astrophysics. Contemporary theme is high energy astrophysics. And that is neutron stars, supernovae, and black holes. But much more important and much more profound is that this discovery marked the end of the Aristotelian view of the universe. There is Mr. Aristotle. His views prevailed for 2,000 years. What did he say, among other things, of course? He said the matter of which the heavens are made is imperishable and thus not subject to generation or corruption. What you see in the sky is permanent. And indeed, it is this permanence that gave man a sense of security. That's why astronomy became the oldest subject. It is the fact that the sky is the same year after year after year. In contrast, Aristotle said, the earth is made up of classical elements and is perishable. The motions in the heavens are eternal and perfect. The heavens are the realm of peace and perfection. Aristotle said the motions are perfect. That means motions are circles. That's why they had great difficulty in understanding planetary motion, because they didn't fit into a circle. So they invented epicycles, till Kepler came along and said it is really an ellipse. Greeks couldn't stand ellipse because that is not perfect. Okay? This was the Aristotelian view of the universe that dominated astronomy for more than 2,000 years. Now, let's listen to what Chandrasekhar said way back in 1932. Let me read it for you. For all stars of mass greater than M, a certain M, the perfect gas equation of state does not break down, however high the density may become, and the matter does not become degenerate. An appeal to the Fermi-Dirac statistics to avoid the central singularity cannot be made. The last sentence of the paper, the great progress in the analysis of stellar structure is not possible before we can answer the following fundamental question. Given an enclosure containing electrons and atomic nuclei of total charge zero, what happens if we go on compressing the material indefinitely? I have not told you about this paper, which we will do next time, I think. The 1934 paper, last sentence. Finally, it is necessary to emphasize one major result of the whole investigation, namely, that it must be taken as well established that the life history of a star of small mass must be essentially different from the life history of a star of large mass. For a star of small mass, the natural white dwarf stage is an initial step towards complete extinction. A star of large mass cannot pass into the white dwarf stage, and one is left speculating on other possibilities. This was written before neutron was discovered. What was the reaction? When Chandrasekhar presented these results at a very important meeting of the Royal Astronomical Society in London in 1935, the president, Sir Arthur Eddington, who traveled on the train from Cambridge to London with Chandrasekhar, never said a word, said this after his talk. I do not know whether I shall escape from this meeting alive, but the point of my paper is that there is no such thing as relativistic degeneracy. Chandrasekhar, using the relativistic formula, which has been accepted for the last 5 years, shows that a star of mass greater than a certain limit M remains a perfect gas and can never cool down. The star has to go on radiating and radiating, contracting and contracting, until I suppose it gets down to a few kilometer radius, when gravity becomes strong enough to hold in the radiation, and the star will at last find peace. It'll become a black hole. Dr. Chandrasekhar had got this result before, but he has rubbed it in his last paper. When discussing with him, I felt driven to the conclusion this was almost a reductio ad absurdum of the relativistic degeneracy formula. The formula must be wrong because it's predicting an absurd result. Various accidents may intervene to save the star, but I want more protection than that. I think there should be a law of nature to prevent the star from behaving in this absurd manner. So this was Eddington's reaction. And he was the most influential person in the world at that time in astronomy. Well, what are the facts? So, why did Eddington reject Chandrasekhar's discovery? Because he was an Indian, because racial prejudice? No. He realized, as we will see in the next lecture, that if Chandrasekhar's result is correct, not the Chandrasekhar limiting mass, but if really massive stars, degeneracy cannot set in, then it will contract and contract and contract, become a black hole and a singularity. To him, this was unacceptable. Indeed, to Einstein, it was unacceptable. But what's the fact? Both Aristotle and Eddington and Einstein were wrong. The heaven is neither serene nor permanent. A star explodes every second somewhere in the universe. A star explodes every 25 years in our galaxy. Then if you scale it to the whole universe, okay? So we have already discovered 3,000 neutron stars in just our own galaxy. And the Chandra X-ray Observatory has discovered neutron stars in other galaxies and black holes. And there are countless number of black holes in the universe. So Aristotle's view of the universe collapsed with the discoveries by Chandrasekhar during the period 1930 and 34. And as we will see tomorrow and the next lecture after that, by the discoveries made by Oppenheimer and his students in 1938 and 39. So the importance of Chandrasekhar's discovery of the limiting white dwarf should be seen in this perspective. Namely, it represented an overthrow of a doctrine that reigned supreme for 2,000 years. So we will end on that note. And in the next lecture, we will discuss even more condensed stars, which are the neutron stars. Okay? And then we will discuss many things about neutron stars before going to black hole. Are there any questions? Two for all elements except hydrogen.
But the star starts out mostly hydrogen.
That's okay, but our story begins after hydrogen is converted to helium, right? See, stars are shining. Therefore, we know there is helium in the core, right? I mean, we didn't know that then. But we know now, right? Because we have found the evidence, we have found the neutrinos, we have found everything, right?
When it does become white dwarf, it does go to mu, it does go to
2. Doesn't matter whether it's a helium white dwarf, or a carbon white dwarf, or an oxygen white dwarf, or an iron white dwarf, or a uranium white dwarf, mu will be 2. He said, why? Don't ask me. That comes from the, I suppose, it just works out that way from the Weizsäcker mass formula, which tells you what the A over Z ratio ought to be, right? Yes.
What actually is meant by no radius and mass?
What one means by that is, that's what I said, by 1934 when you took the full expression and integrated, what it means is that the radius goes on decreasing and then finally the radius goes to 0. What he did at the boat, there was no radius. But that should be now understood as a limiting mass, and the radius goes to 0. So the statement is the following. Forget what was said in 1930. The statement is, a star which is ultra-relativistic cannot be supported by electron pressure. It will collapse to 0 radius.
Till it has unique mass.
At that mass, it will collapse. Oh. You cannot have any mass larger than that. So the Chandrasekhar mass is now to be understood in terms of the limiting mass. Understand? So we will see in later lectures, there is such a limiting mass for neutron stars too. And that is what Oppenheimer did. He was inspired by what Chandrasekhar did. And he said by 1938, people had come to understand that there are other objects like neutrons. Remember, at this time, neutron was not yet discovered. And then after neutron was discovered, the idea of neutron stars was discovered by 1938. And Oppenheimer immediately said, let me calculate whether that also has a limiting mass. Same principles, right? It's just that instead of mass of the electron, mass of the neutron will come in the formulae. Otherwise, it's the same thing. You repeat exactly the same thing. Take the microphone because this is recorded.
So you said, when a star converts to white dwarf, you said there is a kind of vibration over there. So is it somehow related to gravitational waves?
No. Stars vibrate for various other reasons. Even a white dwarf has a very thin atmosphere. It may only be a meter high, but it has a thin atmosphere where there are still atoms and so on, because we see them. Okay, we can see them. Most of the white dwarf is what we said, but there's a very thin layer, maybe a few meters or whatever it is. So it is that which is vibrating. That is due to a very complicated and beautiful phenomenon which was first explained by Eddington. So you should look in Eddington's book. There are other stars, so giant stars, Cepheid. There are stars whose luminosity varies periodically because they're expanding in 4 pi r squared sigma t to the power 4. So as the radius changes, the luminosity goes up and down periodically.
So here we're saying that the vibration is due to the constituent atoms and those things.
Not constituent atoms. There is a feedback, positive feedback mechanism that occurs which makes this gas expand and contract. There's nothing to do with gravitational waves.
Because here we are considering a very massive object, and so.
Massive object doesn't have to emit gravitational waves.
All right.
We will come to that in the fifth lecture. For an object to radiate gravitational waves, it must have a quadrupole moment, which varies with time, so that there is at least a third time derivative of the quadrupole moment. Otherwise, you won't have any gravitation. Just because you have a mass which is oscillating, doesn't mean it will radiate gravitational waves. Any other questions? Yes, speak up.
So, vection of matter is circle. Why it is so?
Why it is convective? Is that the question? Convection. Why there is convection? Well, that is a... I'm not sure I want to discuss that in detail now. But basically, it is the following thing. If I heat a pot of water, this is my gas burner, and the bottom of the vessel is at a temperature T1, the top of the vessel, top of the water is at a certain temperature T2. Gravity is acting in this direction. Now, this heat is conducted upwards by conduction, okay? And electrons are the agents of heat conduction, so the heat is conducted upwards. So when you heat a pot of water, you notice the water is very quiet, it doesn't do anything. But heat is coming up by conduction, so it is quite happy. In this direction, clearly there is a temperature gradient dT by dz. This is the z direction. Gravity is in this direction, right? When this temperature gradient exceeds a certain critical value, And that critical value is determined by acceleration due to gravity. This conduction of heat is not adequate. So what happens is, a blob of matter here, which is hotter, is physically transported up, and a blob of matter which is cold is physically transported down. That's what you see when it boils. It is conduction. So if you want to be convinced of that, drop a few leaves of tea in water and watch it as the water heated till boil. All the tea leaves will be down at the bottom in the center. And then as it heats up, you'll see the tea leaves going up and down. You'll see this convection. So what happens is here, you have a core which is contracting. Therefore, the star is expanding. To satisfy the luminosity, the surface of the star has to cool, because 4 pi r squared sigma t to the power 4 must be the same. Therefore, the temperature gradient is increasing. So when the temperature gradient exceeds that critical value, hydrostatic equilibrium is violated, and the star becomes convective. And we know it's convective, because if you look at this Fraunhofer spectrum of the sun, what you see are only elements which are in the atmosphere. You don't see all these elements that are produced in nuclear reaction. They're all deep at the core. But when the star becomes convective, it's like dredging a lake which is full of silt. So the convection brings the stellar material from the core to the surface. And so if you look at the spectrum of the red giant or a red supergiant, you see elements which are being synthesized in the core. So that's how you know there is convection. Okay. In the sun also there is convection, but only in the outermost layers. And it is that convection that is responsible for generating the magnetic field of the sun and the stars or the earth. Because to generate a magnetic field, you need current loops. The only way I know how to generate magnetic fields. So to have current loops, you need conducting material and you need convection. So the Earth's magnetic field is related to the fact that except for the top 45 kilometers, the rest of the Earth is liquid and it is convective. So if you want to remember one thing, convection sets in when the temperature gradient exceeds a critical value, and that value is determined by properties like specific heat and so on, this acceleration due to gravity. Does that answer your question?
Yeah. Fine. Thank you.
Yes? We'll come to that afterwards. Don't ask more. Say it again.
Does a star attain electron degeneracy before attaining neutron degeneracy in a neutron star?
Let's see, okay? So, I will answer the question, then I'm going to tell you should never ask questions like that. Why? Because it's a very good question you're asking. I'm not saying the question is bad. You should answer it yourself. Because now, if I tell you, you're not going to be any wiser. But I'll tell you, next time you have a question like this, first thing is to have a question. And second thing is to be bothered by not knowing the answer to that question. And then try to figure it out. And then if you can't figure it out, ask somebody else. Okay? Don't give up that pleasure. There's a 45-minute BBC interview with Feynman, and the title of that is The Pleasure of Finding Out. Okay, not that I object to answering your question, but I'm depriving you of this pleasure. Okay, next time, let's see. Degeneracy means EF should be greater than KT. Forget KT. That's the same for neutrons, electrons, protons. It has nothing to do with particles, right? Fine. What is EF? Let's say we are dealing with ordinary non-relativistic thing. EF is proportional to P squared PF squared divided by 2m Therefore, regardless of rest of the details, the Fermi energy is inversely proportional to the mass, right? Therefore, given a number and volume, the Fermi energy of the neutrons will be 2,000 times smaller. Therefore, whereas EF over KT may be satisfied for electrons, and therefore electrons are degenerate, EF may still be less than KT for neutrons and protons. Does that answer your question? Therefore, electron degeneracy will set in first. No, wait a second. Have you understood that? Okay. But neutron degeneracy will also set in. That's what we're going to discuss in the next lecture. So let's not discuss that now. That's what neutron stars are. Okay. Basically the same thing, but it is the pressure of neutrons supporting gravity. But that only happens when you go to much higher densities. So even this factor of 2,000 is overcome by simply going to, because don't forget, sitting here is density to the power 2/3. So despite this factor of 2,000, if I increase the density enormously from 1,000,000 g/cm² to 10^14 g/cm², then neutrons will also become degenerate. Okay? And those are the neutron stars. But next time a question like this, it's a very interesting question. Think it through. Okay, don't be disheartened that instantly you don't know the answer. These are things I've learned by struggling for years. Yes. Yes?
What happens to stars in which, the mass of stars in which degeneracy does not set in the core?
Well, we will see. Those are the stars that will become black holes. That's why Eddington rejected Chandrasekhar's theory. So we will see why Chandrasekhar came to that conclusion next time.
And what is the mass of, like, roughly the range of mass of those stars?
I don't think there's an exact number one can give. Computer calculations seem to suggest this, certainly we know of a star which is 20 solar mass star in calculation show will produce still neutron stars. So it should be more than 20 solar mass. Whether it is 25 or 22 or 30, we don't know. There's some mass beyond which neutron stars cannot form for the reason that you just said. Degeneracy never sets in.
So what is the rate of expansion of the boundaries and contraction of the core? What is the rate of contraction?
Rate?
The rate at which it contracts. Is it a million years or is it?
I don't know the exact answer to that question. It will certainly be in tens of thousands of years, okay? It's not an overnight transition because, but it is still short. Because what you don't see is a star actually becoming a giant. If I say, let me look at 10,000 stars and plot them in this diagram, then if the stellar drama makes the star move very slowly in this diagram, then there should be no gaps in it, right? You understand? But suppose suddenly there is a discontinuous change in the time scale in which it is moving. Let us say, it's like when you look at a TV set, there's an electron beam which is actually doing this, right? Now it's going much faster than 50 milliseconds, which is the persistence time of our vision, right? Otherwise, what you would see is individual dots, right? So what I'm saying is, there are some places where we see gaps in the population, which means there is some discontinuous jump in the kind of time scale we are talking about. So it may not be millions of years, but it is sufficiently short that in a statistical analysis, it seems discontinuous. I will try to see if I can find out roughly what is the time scale. Yeah. Good. So we will stop here. In principle, there should be coffee and we can continue there.